For those of you who follow me on Instagram, you guys saw that I was in Grenada checking out St. George's just a few weeks ago. And thank you to everyone who said hello. It was super, super, super awesome meeting up with all you guys. Anyways, if you want to meet up with me at a future travel destination, I'm traveling a lot currently here in San Diego, then make sure you follow me on Instagram because that's where I announce my travel plans and announce any impromptu meetings. Now, I want to share my trip with you because it was anything but expected. So here's what I learned. Last year, I published a video on the Medical Insider channel called The Truth About Caribbean Medical Schools. Now, in response to that video, a SGU representative reached out to me and he said, hey, you know what? We don't clump all the US schools together. We don't say, oh, all US schools are the same. There's better schools and worse schools. So why do we do that for Caribbean schools? And I said, okay, fair point. There are probably better and worse Caribbean schools. And I talk about the big four in that video, but he actually invited me to check out SGU. And I said, sure. So it turns out that SGU and a lot of other Caribbean schools actually will fly out pre-med advisors. They'll pay for their flights, their hotels, beachfront hotel, food, alcohol, transportation, tours, everything. And it lasts for a full week. And they'll do this with maybe 15, 20 pre-med advisors multiple times per year. So on this trip, I was an honorary pre-med advisor. Now, of course, they spend a lot of time telling you about how great SGU is. Now, this is analogous to how pharmaceutical companies will do the same for doctors, with the hopes that subconsciously doctors are going to then, you know, prescribe their medication over the competitors. And this actually happens. And in medical school, we learn a lot about making sure you don't attend these pharmaceutical events because it will influence you subconsciously. The issue is that pre-med advisors aren't privy to this. And I think it's dangerous because they then go tell their students, oh yeah, SGU is great, but they don't actually have the understanding of the nuances and the data limitations that we'll get to. Anyways, I'll talk more about pre-med advisors and that whole story on the Med School Insiders channel. Now, when I was there, I actually filmed two Day in the Life episodes, and you can actually watch one of them. It's already live with Chelsea Spencer.
Hey guys, so this is kind of an atypical day for me. I have two big tests coming up next week. So today consists of a lot of studying. I'll get a workout in, and I'll practice for my OSCE tomorrow.
And there's another one that's soon to come out. Now, I never censor any of the medical students or residents or attending physicians that are on the Day in the Life series. I let them say whatever they want, but it is important to say that maybe they want to censor themselves, okay? So a student, for example, at a Caribbean school, just hypothetically, not saying this did or did not happen, but they may feel a little apprehensive about talking about certain less than rosy aspects of going to the Caribbean because they don't want to make their program look bad. Is that can backfire on them. They're gonna be applying to residency, maybe they'll get bad letters of recommendation, bad dean's letter, and then that will completely mess up their future life. So keep that in mind. Now, luckily, I work for myself and no one is filtering what I do or do not say, so I can be very honest, very open, very real with you guys, and that's what we're gonna get to. So first, the things I like about SGU and Caribbean medical schools. First, not all Caribbean schools are created equal, and SGU is the strongest even amongst the big four. Now, people used to also consider Ross as really up there, but because there was this hurricane and then Ross had to relocate to Tennessee and now they're on a new island, people have generally bumped that down a little bit and they consider SGU to be number one. Now, if you absolutely had to go to a Caribbean school, which I don't recommend, you should always try USMD, USDO first, but if you had to go Caribbean, and we'll talk about that at the end of the video, then I would say SGU. And that's it for things that I like. There's no point number two. Things I don't like. Now, as we go through this list, keep in mind that SGU and all these other Caribbean schools are for-profit institutions. They are enrolling 1,500 students per year, and actually this year they're opening up another class, so it's gonna be more than 1,500 students per year. To put that in perspective, most US medical schools are between 100 to 150. That's a tenth of the size, less than a tenth of the size. So even though the school is really at capacity and the resources are really spread thin, they're still adding more and more students because it is profitable, for-profit institution at the end of the day. Now, there were a lot of things that set off my bullshit meter, a lot of numbers and statistics that make them look very good, but that don't really make sense. And the thing that really scared me about that whole situation was that I was the only one raising my hand and being like, yo, this doesn't make sense. Pre-med advisors, they don't know better. They never went to medical school. They don't understand the matching process. And the fact that they're not questioning the numbers and that they're just taking them, you know, blindly at face value and then just telling their pre-meds about it is very dangerous and very scary to me. But again, I'm gonna talk about that in a future video. First, step one, the claimed pass rate is 94% and the claimed average step one score is 224. Both decent, right? Better than you would expect for a Caribbean school. Turns out there are two massive caveats that they do not tell you. First of all, to take step one, you first have to take an internal test that essentially qualifies whether or not they will allow you to take step one. If you don't meet that first cutoff, you can't even take step one because, hey, it's gonna make them look bad. Number two, 224 is the average of students that pass step one, not all the students that took step one. So the dean that actually confirmed that 224 was only for students who passed step one told me that in over 15 years of him working there, no one has ever asked him that question. Again, something that's kind of scary. Second, and perhaps the most egregious misrepresentation of the data would be the match and attrition rates. Attrition is essentially the dropout rate. Now, match and attrition are so important because you don't go to medical school just to earn your MD. You go because you want to match into a US residency position, and then you can be a board certified licensed physician working as a doctor. Now they claim their match rate is 93%, very similar to US programs, a little bit lower, but there's a lot of shadiness here and it doesn't make sense. First, okay, the specialties people match into. Most people, myself included, we talk about how if you go to the Caribbean, you're probably gonna end up doing primary care or another specialty that is not competitive. We all know that. You can go look up their match lists yourself to confirm. So there was like one ortho, zero plastics, one derm, two opto in the last couple of years. It's really not a program you want to go to if you're trying to do something that's actually moderately to highly competitive. And you may be thinking, oh, that's great, that's fine. I don't want to do that. I just want to do primary care. But also keep in mind that over 50% of medical students will change their mind from first year to when they actually apply to residency about what specialty they want to go into. And that just makes sense because as a pre-med, you don't have nearly as much exposure as you will as a medical student. Second, the 93% match rate only applies to students who actually applied in the match, right? So every year they have 1,500 students starting at SGU. They have two main classes, and this year they're adding a third, so it's gonna be even more. But out of those 1,500 students, only 1,000 actually apply each and every year. So you say, okay, why is there this huge discrepancy of 500 students? What happened to them? And they'll tell you, oh, you know, some students, they take some time off, they'll repeat a semester or repeat a year. Turns out they actually have a rule where you can only push back two semesters, so 1 year, otherwise they will kick you out. Okay, so let's actually say hypothetically that you can make exceptions to that rule and you can stay longer than just 1 year. So 1 to 2 years, right? Turns out they've had 1,500 students for multiple years in a row, not just the last 2 years, but for several years. And for that reason, you would expect the average number of students who are graduating, even if some students took, you know, some time off, to be 1,500. Otherwise, what happened to them? They have to graduate eventually. So that number should average out to 1,500. But what SGU says is that the attrition rate is only 10%. That doesn't make sense. So I pointed out this inconsistency to the group, and I kid you not, they gave me the runaround 4 separate times. I spoke with deans, I spoke with admissions committee people, I spoke with the supposed expert on clinical rotations and matching, and each and every time, they would give me some spiel about, oh, it's only 10% attrition, and we have 96% match rate, and then I would point out the inconsistency with the numbers, and they'd be like, oh, huh, that's a good point you make. Let me get back to you, I'm gonna check with our expert. And I kept going up, got to the supposed expert, and he was like, huh, that doesn't make sense. Let me get back to you. And then he's like, you know what? I spoke with the guy, he gave me these numbers. I'm sorry, they don't really make sense to me, but this is what we have right now. You know, I'm gonna look into this, I'll get back to you. 4 separate times, the runaround, and it's now been several weeks since I was in the Caribbean. Still don't have any data that actually makes sense. So something doesn't make sense. Their attrition rate is higher than 10%. If you speak with actual SGU medical students, and I spoke with at least 36, most of them will estimate that the attrition rate is at least 30 to 35%. And you may say, well, what does a medical student know? I mean, they have a really good sense of the pulse of their class, right? They have friends who are no longer there. So they have an idea that, okay, it's definitely not 10%, it's gonna be much higher than that. And people were saying at least 30 to 35%, which makes sense when you actually look at the numbers. 1,500 enter, 1,000 graduate. Okay, next, the anatomy lab, which is a complete joke. I'm actually surprised that more people don't highlight this as being a massive, like, downside of going Caribbean. In the US, usually you have 4 to 7 medical students per cadaver, and then you dissect it over the course of your first year, and you learn a lot about anatomy. In the Caribbean, or at least at SGU, I should say, it's essentially just prosection, so they've already been dissected by the TA or a professor, and then you go in, and then they tag structures, and then you get quizzed on it. Not the same at all. In fact, for me, so for a lot of students who go into surgery, as a fourth year, I then was a TA in anatomy, and I volunteered to teach the first year medical students about anatomy, and I was doing prosections. So that made me way better versed at anatomy, such that when I started plastic surgery residency, I was way more prepared. And same with my other colleagues who went into neurosurge or gensurge, having that experience with anatomy is so important. Next, culture shock, and it is massive. Now, the idea of living on a Caribbean tropical island may sound good, but out of the students I spoke with, most of them, I mean, they say it feels more like a prison than a paradise, absolutely 100%. And it's a huge culture shock. You take so many things for granted here in the US, whether that's buying groceries, which is a huge hassle there and kind of crazy as to what you can and cannot buy, or power outages, or just transportation, having Uber and Lyft versus calling a taxi and then the taxi guy doesn't show up. All these little things add up. It is a huge culture shock and it's a completely different experience. So many students who go to SGU end up dropping out in their first semester because they just can't even imagine themselves being there for a few years for medical school. It's just too much. The cost. It is $400,000 and the loan options are not as good as if you were at a US program. That is a massive amount of money. And guess what? Compounding interest. So it's gonna be way more than that by the time you graduate. Remember, SGU and other Caribbean schools are for-profit institutions. And I mean, just look at the fact that they flew me out and like 15 other pre-med advisors bought the flights, beachfront hotel, food, transportation, tour, alcohol, all these things. And not only did they have money to do so, but they continue to do so because it's profitable to them because then the pre-med advisors go back. Anyways, you get that. Okay, student culture. This one is kind of mixed because some students told me it's quite collaborative and other students tell me that it's quite cutthroat. So I can't really comment on that. What I can say though is in the week I was there experiencing the environment, when I was in medical school, it was a small class, we all knew each other, and it was like really happy, upbeat, positive vibes most of the time. There are times when it's challenging, but that vibe just like was not the same at SGU. It was tired and kind of like we've grinded so hard and we're exhausted and kind of like our souls are being crushed sort of vibe. It was not a happy place. Some students I actually spoke with said like, hey, I'm not smart enough or I can't do this or that. And that's a really sad attitude to have, man. That's not serving you. That's not serving your future patients. And I get it. I get why someone would have that attitude. But if you are a Caribbean student, understand that at any moment, just like that, you don't have to like work on it, but just like that, you can choose to have a different and better attitude about things. You can choose to let that negativity fuel your fire. But on the other hand, if you are a pre-med student, you do not want to put yourself in that environment because putting yourself in that environment just makes things harder. Now, lastly, student support. I think it's good that they have student support, but it's woefully inadequate. A lot of students have actually told me that if you want to schedule time with a mental health professional, it is extremely challenging. Now, when it comes to the study strategies and optimization, it's literally just second year students teaching first year students, because again, just gotta save the money. So why hire a professional full-time tutor when you can just have students teach other students? Now, I made two videos on the Med School Insiders channel about Caribbean medical schools, links in the description. And I recommend you watch those for a more thorough and formal and more comprehensive description of Caribbean medical schools. This one is more kind of just my take from my experience. But one point I want to emphasize or re-emphasize from those previous videos is that there are multiple factors that contribute to the suboptimal numbers at Caribbean schools. Attrition rate is very high in the Caribbean. That's not good. The match list results are not good. The step one scores and results are not good. But that's in part due to the Caribbean schools, but also in part due to the students, because on average, the caliber of a Caribbean medical student is not going to be to the same degree as a US medical student. Are there exceptions? Absolutely. So look at Chelsea Spencer from that first day in the life video. She is kick-ass and hardcore, and she would excel anywhere, whether in the US or Caribbean. But a lot of students are just not up to the same degree, on average, as a US student. So even if you pick them up, put them in the same program, on average, the US student would do better. Now, I'm just raising this point for complete transparency, just to be fully accurate, because I believe it's not a matter of being smarter or not. It's a matter of strategies and habits and systems. And I mean, that's why I started Med School Insiders, was to teach people like, hey guys, it's not about how smart you are, it's about how smart you study. And we've worked with a lot of students who are in the Caribbean and we've helped them crush step one and crush their shelves. So I fully believe, and like I've obsessed over study strategy optimization, I fully believe anyone can do it. But just keep in mind that the average caliber is lower at a baseline, not in terms of full potential, but at a baseline. So again, suboptimal results are due to one, Caribbean schools themselves not offering the same level of experiences and opportunities and support, etc., but also Caribbean students on average not being as strong. Now, the main thing I would change about those two previous videos is if you are going to apply to a Caribbean program, do a lot of research. And first of all, well, before I say that, do not go to the Caribbean unless you have fully exhausted your US options. So that means applying to US MD and DO programs at least two cycles. And also like work with people who have medical school admissions committee experience. I'm not saying this to plug my own business. I'm saying this because this will actually help you get into a US program. We had a lot of students who applied twice, sometimes even three times to US programs, didn't get in. They work with our team and either they improve their numbers, the hard stats, the hard parts of the application, or the soft elements, the personal statement, the interview, the secondary, and then they get into US programs. That is an optimal situation. You want to be in the US at an MD or a DO program. But if you've exhausted all your options and Caribbean does make sense for you, then go to an accredited medical school in the Caribbean. Go to one that's, I mean, within the big four even, do your research, because going to a smaller school with really high attrition rates, with really bad step results and match results, then, I mean, you don't wanna have 400K in debt and not a good way to pay it off. It's just life crippling. Anyway, guys, that is it for this video. Thank you all so much for watching. Much love to you all, and I will see you guys in that next one.